Welcome again to Lakeshore Focus, a weekly show highlighting the key issues, important events, and interesting people in our region. I'm Keith Kirkpatrick. All around the world, the United States of America is still viewed by many as the land of opportunity. In 1931, James Truslow Adams defined the American dream with, "Life should be better and richer and fuller for everyone, with opportunity for each according to ability or achievement." Many came to the States believing in the American dream, thinking that they wouldn't be limited by social class or circumstances. The question, is the American dream alive and well today? We're joined by two business owners transplanted to the U.S. Meet Aida Lugo McAllister, owner of Aida's Kitchen a la Criolla, and Deauke Robbens, the owner of Barn Sante. Did I get both your names right?
Deauke.
Deauke.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna work at this. I got it earlier, didn't I?
Yeah, you did.
Okay, all right. So, you actually started in America, right?
But yes.
But your family is from?
Puerto Rico. Both my parents were born and raised in Puerto Rico, and they came here in the 1940s to pursue employment opportunity in this area because of the steel mill industries.
Okay, which we have a lot of people in this area that have done that. And you've arrived here because?
Because of my husband's job. So it had finished in Belgium, so we had an opportunity to either go to China or to US. So we took US.
Was it a hard decision?
It was for him, not for me. I love adventure, and I immediately said yes, let's do it.
You said I want to go to the US.
Well, US wasn't really the country I was dreaming of going to.
Where'd you want to go?
To Italy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So nice weather, and because I read about, I went through winter here, so.
So welcome to Northwest Indiana. This is awesome. Now, your family's been here a while, but you moved back to Puerto Rico for
yes,
a while?
Yes, I moved. As a child, I would vacation in Puerto Rico. But at age 17, I decided to move to Puerto Rico and live there for many years. I even had the opportunity of getting my bachelor's degree at the University of Puerto Rico. And also seek employment, and I worked for two major manufacturing company in Puerto Rico.
So why'd you move back to the U.S. then? Sound like things were pretty good for you in Puerto Rico.
Your
education, jobs?
It was pretty good being in a beautiful island surrounded by the ocean.
Sounds like Italy, right?
Kind yes, of 80 kind of degrees, thing. You know, and it was beautiful, but when I was working, for example, in this pharmaceutical company, I was earning like $300 a month. And at that time, you know, I even had a master's degree. And I tried to look for an apartment. I couldn't even afford an apartment because the housing prices and the rental.
So you said, I'm moving back to the U.S. That decision was what, about 12 years ago or so?
No, that was done in almost 30 years ago.
Okay, so you just came back, and so here you are, and you're ready to start a business, and I'll come back to that. So you find yourself over here in near Chicago, mm-hmm. you know, across the ocean from your country and family,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yep.
And so you've decided to open a business. Why is that?
Well, we've only been here for 10 months. So in the beginning, I really held on to this, I'm going to Italy after this, or we're going to Italy after this. Let's do this for 3 years and then we're gone. But we met amazing people and we love the countryside. And then it started growing that, you know, what shall I do in these 3 years? I cannot just be a housewife. That's really not me. So seeing what other people started up here and what they did, and I thought, you know, I can do a lot. I was a freelance trainer, self-employed in Belgium, and I thought maybe I should try to do the same thing here. And the more I met people, the more I felt supported with my ideas. So then I said, okay, let's.
I'm going to go for it.
I go for it.
So,
yes.
And you're in LaPorte now, right?
We're in LaPorte now.
You're living in LaPorte,
yes.
And you love it there.
Yeah, we've just moved 2 weekends ago.
Okay.
When we moved over, we were 3 months in a hotel in La Porte, the Blue Heron. We didn't have a house yet. Then we went to Porter Beach, to the dunes, a house in the dunes, temporary rental, until we now found this amazing place.
And you're loving it. And you live in Valpo, right?
Yes.
Is that where you've been for a long time?
I lived in Chesterton for around 7 years before I moved to Valpo. And I decided to become an author of a bilingual Puerto Rican cookbook.
Wow, now that's interesting.
Yes, and so the book has been published for a year, and what is amazing is the Porter County, including Portage, Chesterton, but specifically Valpo. Valpo is a city that has truly embraced diversity in the community.
So you feel pretty good being there.
They have given me a lot of support. The Valparaiso Chamber, the Chesterton Doolin Chamber. They have even given me guidelines or other people to help me in my book selling, like Barnes & Nobles.
So you guys are like really pretty positive about this, which is terrific. So what possesses somebody to want to write a cookbook? There's millions of cookbooks, right? They're all over the place. So why would you decide to write a cookbook?
Cooking has always been a hobby. I have been cooking since age 12. Then I started taking cooking classes. In addition, you know, after I retired as an accountant, that's where I got my degrees. But my hobby was cooking. And being married to an Irish.
Which was a good choice.
Yes, a very good choice. Yes. I started cooking Puerto Rican food to his family and friends, and everybody wanted my recipes. So I decided, why not make this a cookbook? Because I even had to go to their homes and teach them. So I said, why not do this cookbook and do it bilingual?
And you've now are trying to start a business that does this instruction and
sells
things?
Well, now I'm planning to open a restaurant in Valparaiso.
Okay.
But in the meantime, once my book came out, I became a cooking instructor at U Cook in Merrillville.
Okay.
And
man, you're doing lots of interesting
and
things.
And a lot of doors has opened. And the best part about this U Cook in Merrillville is that my class was one of the few classes that they had to advertise, and it would be full at capacity. And that's almost teaching there for a year, and that's when I realized, let me open a restaurant.
So I see they're going to come to your restaurant and eat all this great, rich food, and then they're going to have to go work out with Deauke?
Is that absolutely.
The deal? Because you're going to be doing some fitness and training, but you also are producing jewelry?
Yes. So I have several projects under the same roof, but I would say it all... comes down to happier and healthier lives. So I will be doing workouts, body workouts, very short programs, 30 minutes. We want it to be time efficient so we can have time to go
to a restaurant. There we go.
For example.
I like that idea.
Yeah. I will be doing also workshops for the mind. We want to lower our stress level, which is very high nowadays, and get more concentrated at job or at home.
Have you always been entrepreneurial? Have you always been kind of that start my own thing?
I did it last year. I had started. I had some bad experience with employers, so I always give it 200%, and then something goes wrong with the employer, or they stop the business or whatever. And at a certain point, I said, okay, I can do this and I can do it much better.
I'm going to do it. So both of you see opportunity. I mean, a lot of people are really afraid to jump into something like this. Mm. Why have you not been afraid to do that? Why have you not been afraid? Or have you been afraid?
Well, I think there is some fears and challenges, but you have to put that aside and you have to follow your dream. And as long as you give it more than 100%, whether the outcome doesn't, you know, whether you succeed or not, you've met a lot of people, you've learned a lot, and but I believe that we will be successful because of our personality.
Mm-hmm. Have you had some level of fear about this? I mean,
Yes, I do, but when I tell my ideas to friends and family, then when I feel a little bit of support, I go for it. And of course, there's always my husband who supports me in almost everything I do. So that is just, he's a, you know, big buddy and friend. And
we won't ask you the almost part, you know, he doesn't support you in, you know, you sound like you both have felt, I mean, here you both really have backgrounds from other places. You clearly have an accent, so people see you and say, well, she's got to be from someplace else. Do you feel that you're kind of embraced by the community? I mean, it's like they like having you here, or you feel like, ooh, you're a foreigner?
My experience here in Valparaiso has been beautiful. They have embraced not only me as an individual, my ethnic background, but also my cookbook. And there are the ones that are pushing me to open a Puerto Rican restaurant.
That is so good to hear. Mm. How about you?
I feel the same way. I feel very, very embraced, very welcome. And same like Aida says, I feel that they support me and it helps me to go for it.
Do you hear stories from people who've, you know, come here from other places where their experience has not been like this? Do you hear stories like that, or?
I've heard, there was, in fact, when my book came out in October of 2013, at the same time, the following week in the newspaper, they announced a Puerto Rican restaurant opening in Lake Station, and that closed immediately. And I never realized or never pursue as to why, but it kind of put a little bit of fear and concern. But at that time, I wasn't even thinking about opening a restaurant because I was concentrating in, you know, doing book signings and pursuing other avenues like a cooking instructor. And I did very well with my cookbook. And but yes, you do get, you know, you hear around here, like that Brazilian restaurant closed as well.
Right. On Route 30. It was there quite a while, though, right?
Yeah, it was there quite a while.
So you've met a lot of Americans over here, and you're being from Belgium. There's probably not a lot of Belgian transplants here, right?
No.
Okay, but do you run across people who've come here from other places, or just, and you have some affinity toward, oh, somebody else who's got an accent, right?
Oh, yeah, we've met, we have some great friends from the UK. Puerto Rico. But I must say we mostly, you know, try to integrate. We're not here to find other expats. We're really here to integrate into the culture of the States.
Do you think America is still a land of opportunity for people? I mean, do you hear that, the American dream?
Well, I wasn't even thinking of the American dream when I came here. Remember, I wanted just to leave after 3 years to Italy.
You had the Italian dream.
Yes.
Right?
But now, also with being invited here in the show, it makes me think that, you know, am I really pursuing the American dream and setting up my own business and being motivated to help the locals get happier and healthier? I'm starting to believe, you should pursue it and try to be successful.
Was it easy to try to start a business back in Belgium? Could you just like, hey, I think I'll start a business and make it go?
To be honest, I have the feeling that it's a little bit easier here.
Okay.
Yeah, it's,
Better opportunity.
Yes.
How do you see that? Do you see that kind of opportunity that still exists for people from other places to come here and go, I can make it in America?
Oh, I believe in the American dream, definitely. Especially now with there's more Puerto Ricans living in the United States, 4.9 million compared to in Puerto Rico, 3.5 million. And one of the reasons, many of the reasons, one is the housing prices in Puerto Rico is very high. The job situation, the economic opportunity is here. The household income is very low. Even with the same position, there is like $30,000 less compared to the same position here in the United States.
Well, we still see, you know, people come over here from, you know, India, Pakistan, all over the world. They still come to America and say, you know, I'm going to jump in here and buy a business, start a business, you know, whatever that may be. So back home, back in Puerto Rico or back over in Europe, did you hear people talk about that, like America's still a good place to go to, or it's a great place to vacation, or what was that perception of people about our country?
The Belgians, when I go back home, well, not home, to Belgium, people, when I tell them that I live here now, they their first thing that they say, and I'm now defending my country here, they say, Americans, they're so superficial. Do you perceive that? And I say, yeah, what do you mean with superficial? And there's always discussion about the States or the Americans being superficial. So, people talking about coming here and setting up a business, it's, I think for Belgium, the States is just a little bit too far. People who want to set up something back in Belgium would rather pick out a European country. We know people who now set up a bed and breakfast in Spain. They would go to Italy, Spain, France.
Particularly Italy,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Yeah, keep mentioning it.
We keep coming back to Italy over and over. I'm not sure what that's about. I think there's still a draw, but you do seem to be loving America, so we're loving our area. So when you're back home visiting family or friends in Puerto Rico, what is their perception still at this point of the United States?
Well, today, definitely, they are coming to the United States to pursue their dream. I have relatives today that I grew up in the late 70s, early 70s, all the way to early 80s, that I thought would never leave Puerto Rico. And today, a lot of them are now, I mean, that I didn't think they would live in the United States. And today, they are living in the United States because of that American dream.
So what is your reaction? I mean, you can't live in this country without following in the media and the press. There's a lot of people in this country who don't like people like you coming over here and people like you living here. And they'd like everybody to stay back in their own countries and not come here. What do you think about that or hear?
I don't hear it personally, so I don't perceive that. But I would say I understand the people who think that or say that because, you know, everyone is just coming in here and stealing their business or whatever. So I understand it.
You understand that fear?
I do.
That you think that's a real fear? Are these people really coming here? Are you really coming here to take somebody's job and steal their business?
I hope not, but I would say the States is so big, and be creative and set up something unique, and so that everyone is given a chance to, you know, do business in the States.
So do you hear that kind of concern about people, you know, being apprehensive about, you know, and all that negativity about, you know, keep those people out of the country, but you don't feel it?
I don't feel it.
What do you think about it when you hear it?
I've read a lot about it, but the United States from day one, especially New York, you know, a lot of people migrated to New York. At least in Puerto Rico, they migrated, but other countries, they came here as well to pursue that American dream. So from day one, we are from all over. You know, we really are, it's like a melting pot. Mm-hmm. And in Puerto Rico, we are Europeans. We are from Africa. We are initially Indian Tainos. And believe it or not, we have, you know, Italian, British, French, Dutch, Spaniard, number one, that first came. So we are a melting pot in Puerto Rico as well.
Yeah. One of the things I like about this region is the fact that we are very diverse, and if people will look around, you really will see people from all over the country. So I'm going to give you a 10-second pitch on your business. So why should somebody buy some jewelry from you or come to you to get in better shape? Why should they?
Because I work out programs that are very time efficient. No one has an excuse anymore to not work out. And the jewelry
is cool.
Yes, there's the stones are sourced at Lake Michigan.
Okay, all right, that's cool.
So very local.
10-second advertisement for why they should come once you open your restaurant up.
Oh, they should come to taste the ethnic Puerto Rican cuisine and learn about the history of how those food, special products came to the island, because it's not just serving the food, I also give the history about the food.
Okay, I love history and I love food, so I'm going to be there, Aida.
Thank you.
All right?
Thank you so much.
So let me know when you open up.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you for both being on the show.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
I have always been inspired by the stories of people who came to America for a better life. Imagine it's the turn of the century, last century, the early 1900s. Arriving on a ship where he was housed in the cargo hold as a young man from Italy, which we've talked about. He departs Ellis Island with no money and only a small valise containing a few items of clothing. Wandering the streets of New York City, he considers where he will sleep, what he will eat, and where he might earn some coin to pay for both. His heart is light and he is excited because he has come to the land of opportunity. Eventually, he discovers a bustling place of business where barrels and crates are being loaded and unloaded from wagons and carts. He jumps in and begins to help. The foreman watches him for a while thinking, hey, let him work. He is not costing me a cent. After some time passes, the boss notices that this guy is moving more freight than any of his paid workers. Soon he walks up to the young man and in some way communicates that he is impressed with his work ethic and will pay him for his labor. So begins the odyssey of another immigrant to America. Eventually, our new arrival establishes his reputation as a highly productive part of the company and becomes a boss himself. Sometime later, he breaks away, starts his own successful company, and keeps a constant eye open for that next young man who has arrived in America looking for his first opportunity. This story could be told with people from Greece, Mexico, China, Ireland, or other places. It may have been about a woman who washes clothes, takes care of children, or works in a tavern. No matter the tale, its theme is one of seeing the chance to start a new life and make it in the land of promise. America has held this fascination for large numbers of people over a long period of time. If the story is not about a new arrival, it is often about a born and bred American who dreams of a better life, achievement, and success. I think we still offer those hopes to many, and it is part of our fabric, another factor that still makes America a great place. Thanks for watching our show. Did we inspire or educate you in some way? You can send thoughts and feedback to us through the email address listed on your screen. Check out our website. It is full of interesting features. Specifically, you can watch past episodes of Lakeshore Focus. Just go to www.lakeshorepublicmedia.org. Click on the TV, scroll down till you see my picture with a different jacket and tie. One more click and you can view a list of previously aired shows. Tell your friends and family that you watch Lakeshore Public Television. Join us next week for another Lakeshore Focus. Until then, I'm Keith Kirkpatrick saying, make a positive difference in our world today.